Okay, so one quick reminder, right after class, I'm going to post a little sign-up thing for the circuit board meetups. And I'd like to get them all, well, okay, for a couple of reasons, I don't think we're going to be able to do all of those meetings this week. I'm going out of town on Friday afternoon to a conference, and then, I've got some other crap going on today. But I do at least want to get them all scheduled by the end of the week. Okay, so even if I'm sure some of them are going to have to spill into next week. So pay attention to Canvas for updates about that. All right, so let's revisit my magic trick. And I'm not a very good magician in the sense that I'm perfectly willing to show you why the trick works. And I'll also be pulling a rabbit out of a hat, right? All right, so somebody give me a couple of numbers. In fact, let's spice this up and do three-digit numbers. 439 and 726. Okay. And this one's a little spicier than last time because what do we have to do if we want to do the subtraction grade school style? I'm going to have to borrow and carry, right? And then borrow and carry and get an 8 and then a 2. So 287. Yay. Okay. So that's the grade school way of doing this, right? And you all remember how to do grade school subtraction. I would really hope so. All right. So what's my magic trick? I'm going to take 439 and I'm going to mirror all of its digits. So 4 becomes 5, 3 becomes 6, and 9 becomes, 0. Right? And then I'm going to add 1 to that. And so I have 561. I'm going to take 726 and 561, and I'm going to add them and discard anything that spills over into the thousands place. And I get 7, 8, and 2 with a carry, which I discard. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so why did this work? Well, let's take the particular numbers that I did here, right? Okay, so how do I get 9 became a 0? What I did was I subtracted the digit that was there. Okay, so my original number 439, I'm going to transform to be 9 minus 0 in the ones place and 6, sorry, 3, 9 minus 3. Here, I need some more space here. Let's do it this way. Okay, so 9 minus 4 in the hundreds place, 9 minus 3 in the tens place, 9 minus 9 in the ones place, and I'm going to add 1 to that. Okay, so my transformed number is that. Yes? Okay, the original number, what was it? 726 is 7 times 10 to the second plus 2 times 10 to the first plus 6 times 10 to the 0 plus 1. Or, sorry, not plus 1 here. Okay, so when I add these things, what am I doing? I'm adding the corresponding pieces, okay? And this plus 1 that's key to the trick, that's a 1. So could I actually include him inside here because he's a 1, not a 10 or 100 or whatever? Yeah? Is it okay? Okay, so in that position, what I actually have is, let me rewrite it. I actually have 9 minus 4, 10 squared, plus 9 minus 3, 10 to the first, plus 10 minus 9, 10 to the 0. And I'm adding 7, 10 to the second, 2, 10 to the first, and what was it, 6, 10 to the zero. Okay, so how many, if I start adding in the ones place, okay, how many 10 to the zeros do I end up with? Well, 10 minus 9 plus 6, right? So I'm going to write that as 10 minus 9 plus 6. And then similarly, what do I have in the next places? 9 minus 3 plus 2 and 9 minus 4 plus 7. Okay, does that make sense? Yes. So I used 9 three times because that was the mirroring, right? So I'm not saying that 439 is actually equal to this. It's just that's the transformed version, right? Because so what I really have here is this thing which looked like 561, right? Does that make sense? Right, so instead of subtracting 439, I'm actually adding this thing that looks like 561. Okay, does that make sense? Okay, so yeah, fair question. Okay, so if I add the ones place, the tens place, the hundreds place, and so on, then this is what I've got, right? And, but you might notice here, what's 10 minus 9 plus 6? It's 7, okay? And yeah, okay, it's 7, right? So I have 7, 10 to the first, or 0, sorry. And then what about in the next place? Eight, 10 to the firsts, and in the next place after that, what do I get? 12, and so I'm going to do 2 10 to the seconds, and I'm going to discard anything that goes over into the next place. And is that the correct number? 287. Yeah? So there we go. Okay, that's maybe not super satisfying, but whatever. Okay, the point is, it works. Okay. Okay, so what I have done here is called the tens, well, 9 and tens complement. So when I mirrored all of the digits and turned 439 into 560, 560 is called the nines complement. So let me write that out over here. And then the 561, after I add that extra one, which is key to the trick, that becomes the tens complement. Okay, is that all right? Okay, so what we want to do with this is basically figure out how could we adapt this trick to doing binary arithmetic. Okay, and the hint is it's actually easier in binary than it is in base 10, because what does 1 mirror with? 0. And what does 0 mirror with? And is there anything else to worry about? Nope. That's it. Yeah? So we don't have to think as hard about the mirroring because there's only two symbols that we have, 0 and 1. That's it. Whereas in base 10, we had to remember, now what is 0 mirror with, what is 4 mirror with, and so on, okay? All right, so let's go on to the next sheet here. And let's start to do this with binary. Okay, so let me just demonstrate this, and I'll demonstrate it with some 4-bit numbers, which are small, okay? But the idea then generalizes to, like, was there anything about this trick that depended on there only being three digits? I did two digits at the end of last time. Here I did three digits. Could I have done as many digits as you guys had desired? Yeah, and how would it work? I would just have to keep doing more of the same thing. Okay, so same thing in binary. So let's do it for 4 bits just for sake of demonstration. All right, so what I need here is I need 2 4-bit numbers. A 4-bit number, I can represent a total of 16 different possibilities. Okay, so let me just choose sort of semi-arbitrarily here 8 and 5 as demonstration numbers. Or actually, you know what? Let me not do 8. Let me do 7 and 5. Okay, for reasons that'll become clear later. Okay, so what is 7 in binary? Okay, and what is 5 in binary? Yeah, I need a 4 and no 2s. There we go. And that's the worst looking 5 ever. Okay, so what is, of course, the difference between them? 2, right? Last time I checked, the difference was 2. And how would we do the subtraction here, grade school style? Well, what's 1 minus 1? 0. What's 1 minus 0? 1. What's 1 minus 1? 0. What's 0 minus 0? Excuse me, 0. And is that binary number, does that represent 2? Yes. Okay. So grade school arithmetic works pretty much the same way, except, you know, when you have to borrow, then you're borrowing a 1, not a 10. Yeah. Okay. So let's revisit the trick. What was the trick? I need to mirror all of the digits. So I'm going to take this and I'm going to turn it into its ones complement. And then I'm going to add 1 to get its twos complement. Okay, so what did I do to get from 0101 to 1010? All the ones became zeros and all the zeros became ones. Okay, in the same way that when I did this with base 10 numbers, 9 became 0, 8 became 1, 7 became 2, and so on. Okay? And then I added 1. That's required for the trick. So I'm going to take the original number, 7. I'm going to take this new number and I'm going to add them. All right, what's 1 plus 1? 0 carry a 1, right, which is 2. Okay, what's 1 plus 1 plus 1? 1 carry a 1. What's 1 plus 1 plus 0? 0 carry a 1. What's 1 plus 0 plus 1? 0 carry a 1, and a final carry is discarded, so I remain only with a 4-bit number. Okay, and is this the correct answer? Yes. All right, so let me kind of take a pause from this and I will come back to it in just a second. But there's sort of one other thing I need to talk about. Okay, so are questions about this right this instant? No? Okay. So, computer arithmetic in some sense works very similar to human arithmetic, okay, with one very important exception. If I gave you two big numbers and asked you to add them together, so let's just say I give you 9 million and 1 million. What's the sum of that? 10 million. So what do you have to do sometimes when you do addition? You have to carry into the next position. Right? And your number might have more digits than what the individual one started with. Yes? Okay. Is there any limit to how many digits you can keep? tacking on as necessary. No, there's no theoretical limit. I mean, you can't tack on a million digits. You might be kind of at it for a long time, but adding, you know, if you have to add on 6 more digits or 12 more digits, or who cares, right? In math, you just keep tacking on digits. Okay, that's not the way that computer arithmetic works, though. You have to realize that the computer only ever uses a specific number of bits for its arithmetic, no more. Okay, now on modern computers, this is often 32 or 64 bits with which you can express a lot of stuff. 64 bits gets you a whole hell of a lot of stuff. Old school computers from back in the day were only capable of doing 8-bit arithmetic. Okay, and so I'm going to use like 4 and 8-bit arithmetic as what will compute for two reasons. One, there's just less stuff to write down, and so it's faster. But two, it will better illustrate the issue that we're going to run into. Okay, so let's talk about integer encoding. And we said last time that there are two types. We can have unsigned integers, and we can have signed integers. Okay, unsigned integers are things that can only be zero and positive. Signed integers could be negatives or positives, but also zero. Okay, and the unsigned system is easy. We talked about that last time. Okay, all right, so let's suppose that we use n bits. With the unsigned, you can represent all of the numbers from 0 up to 2 to the n minus 1. Okay, for example, let's say that we have 8 bits. You can represent everything up to 255, which is equal to 2 to the 8th minus 1. Okay, so if I can represent the numbers 0 up through 255, how many total numbers have I represented? 256, which is exactly 2 to the 8th. Okay, now why is 2 to the 8th such an important number here? Well, how many bits do I have if I'm, well, how many bits do I have? 8. If I say I'm going to have 8 bits for my arithmetic, 2 to the 8th is the number of 8-bit patterns that we could write down. Right, because does any one bit determine what any of the other ones are? They're all independent, and so you multiply, right? This is 8 coin flips. Same thing, okay? And so we get, we can represent a total of 256 things. Makes sense to be able to represent 0. So how many are left for positive numbers? Only 255, and that's why it goes up to 255 and not 256. Okay, and the math here is the same for any number of bits, right? So for example, if I have 32 bits, I can represent up to 2 to the 32 minus 1. Now 2 to the 32 is a rather large number. It's like 4 point something billion, right? So with 32-bit unsigned integers, I can represent up to, you know, 4 point whatever billion. That's pretty big. Probably big enough for most applications, maybe not financial stuff, if you're like the stock market or a government. But would that probably be just fine for your checkbook? Yeah, and if any of y'all's checkbooks are at extreme risk of exceeding 4 point something billion, then I'd like to take you out to dinner for, you know, steak and lobster tail and the finest bottle I can find in Dom Perignon, right? be like, "So, how's it going?" Okay, so right. The sign system is what I want to concentrate on next. Okay, meaning what happens if you're allowing the concept of negatives to be involved? Well, we split things. So in human math, how do I denote that a number is negative? I put a negative sign in front of it, right? But here's the problem. I can't encode a negative sign with just a zero or a one. Okay? So this would be like going back to the magic trick I started with and saying, you know what? I want you to write down the idea of subtraction, but you can't use the minus symbol. That's verboten. Then how would you know whether or not a number is positive or negative? Okay? All right. So, let's take the 8-bit representation for the number 5. Okay? It would just be this. Four. Okay, so this representation is the same both as a signed and an unsigned integer because the number's small enough. That's not going to be true for all of them, but we'll see that in a moment. Okay, perfectly good number. Yeah? What would you guys guess? The bit pattern would be for -5. If we were designing a system, what might be a good way to do this? Or what might be a way? It may not be a good way. Well, what about if I make that bit on the far left be the sign? And if the bit on the far left is a 1, that means that my number is negative, and otherwise it means it's not. Seem like a reasonable guess? Okay. Because I can't write the minus sign, so why don't I just use one of the bits to sort of do that? Okay. All right. Now, that turns out not to be exactly the way that we do it, and here's why. So if I guessed that this is -5. What have I done? I've taken 5 and I've sort of put this minus in front of it. Does that make sense? Yes. Does it not have what now? Sort of. We'll come back to that. It's not 4 billion, it's like 250, whatever. Okay. Okay. So actually, what I want to Let me be clear. What I'm about to write down is or what I am writing down right now is a steaming pile of crap. It's not going to work, but I want to illustrate why it doesn't work. Okay, so let's say that we were just naive and we said, okay, 5, that's fine, right? No big deal. And so why don't we just try representing -5 with the bottom number, right? Just make that far left bit represent my minus sign. Okay, what would happen if I add 5 and -5? What should I get? I had damn well better get 0, right? And if I don't, then this system is stupid. Well, add those two numbers together, please. And what do you get? I get 0 carry, 0 carry, 0001. Does that look like 0 to you? No. Okay. So our guess was a stupid guess. Okay? It maybe seemed reasonable from the get-go, but it turned out not to work because do we want to have to completely change the way addition works here just because we're using binary instead of base 10? No. Okay? So that doesn't work. So what we have to do then is talk about what does work. And what does work is basically to adapt our magic trick. Okay? All right. Is it clear why that doesn't work? Okay. Now, it will be true that the far left bit will tell you whether or not you have a negative. Okay, that part's okay. But you don't just flip the far left bit and call it a day. You got to do way more than that. All right, the other reason that this is a terrible idea would be, what would be the bit pattern for zero? All zeros, right? Well, what about if I make one followed by all zeros? What would that represent in this nonsense system? Negative zero? So there's positive and negative zero? Does that make sense? No, that's silly, right? There should only be one zero. Yeah? Okay, so that doesn't work. And so what we have to do is this 2's complement stuff. Okay, so let me take the number 5 that I have here. Okay, and I've got its bit pattern. Okay, so this is what does work, is to use 2's complement. All right, what was 5? It was that, right? What did we do in our magic trick if I wanted to subtract 5? I flipped the bits and the added 1, right? Okay, so let's flip the bits and add 1 and see what we get. Okay, so if I flip the bits, I get 1111 1010. This is the 1's complement. If I add 1 to that, what do I get? 1111 1011. This is the 2's complement. Okay, so same as my magic trick, right? I mirrored all of the bits and added 1. Good? Okay, now, what was our demonstration? So the thing I crossed out in red, how did I test whether or not I had a reasonable, like, if I had something that was actually going to be useful? I added it to, I added 5 and negative 5. What should I get if things are working out nicely? I should get 0. Okay. Well, so I have this bit pattern that I claim represents minus 5. I also have the bit pattern that I started with that represented 5. What should happen if I add those together? I should get 0. Well, let's find out. Okay, so what was my original number? 5, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1. And negative 5, I claimed, is this new bit pattern here. Add those, please. I'll let you guys take a second and do that. And if I haven't screwed anything up, what should we get? We should get 0. Okay, so get cracking on the doing the arithmetic there. I need to get those people on YouTube that have the 1 minute later, right? Insert those little videos in there into the stream. No. Where do those come from? SpongeBob or something? Okay, that makes sense. And you guys are young enough that when you guys were, 6 or 7, were you all watching SpongeBob religiously? Pretty much, yeah. SpongeBob didn't exist when I was that age. I was watching, Inspector Gadget's, Danger Mouse, Banana Man. Those are 2 British cartoons. Ben, did you ever watch any Danger Mouse or Banana Man?
Danger Mouse, yeah.
Yeah, okay. Penfold? Right. Oh, that reminds me. Have you ever been to the Magic Roundabout?
Yes.
Have you driven through the Magic Roundabout? So you guys know what a roundabout is, right? Yeah. Okay, there's several places in England, but the one in particular where there are five roundabouts arranged in a roundabout. So it is a roundabout of roundabouts. And they call it the Magic Roundabout because there was a kids show back in like the 60s that had that as its name. And oh good God, it makes me want to like it's just terrifying to look at. I'll show you a picture actually. Well, once you're there, but you're also driving on the wrong side of the road and sitting in the wrong side of the car, and Swindon, which fortunately is not too hard to spell, unlike, okay, so there's the map, right? It's a five roundabouts arranged in a row. And there's what it looks like on the map, but let's find a picture of it. Oh, that picture sucks. Here we go. No, just no, right? Or there, right? That's terrifying.
So what happens in those
Huh? Nothing. Yeah. I mean, every time I'm playing Cyberpunk and I'm going, what is it between Chinatown and Japantown where there's that giant circle? You guys know what I'm talking about, right? That's kind of how I feel. I'm like, why is this here? So, yeah. Anyway. Okay, so what did you guys get? Did it add up to zero? Yes, with one minor detail. What was that minor detail? What did you have at the final end? You had an extra carry, which we discard because we're only using 8 bits. Okay, so the key to this, and in fact, this is sort of the other key to my magic trick, is when I did the magic trick with 3 digits, I was saying three shall be the number of the digits, and the number of the digits shall be three. Four is right out. Okay, actually, five is right out, but how many of you guys know what I'm referencing there? Just one person? Seriously? How many of you guys have not seen Monty Python and the Holy Grail? Right, the instructions for the Holy Hand Grenade of Antioch. Counteth unto three, thou shalt not count unto four, five is right out. After counting unto three, pulleth out thy holy pin, and lob thy holy hand grenade of Antioch at thy foe, may it be blown to bits in thy mercy. Right? Yeah, okay. So, yes, eight shall be the number of the bits for this example, and the number of the bits shall be eight. Done. So that final carry is discarded. And what do I end up with? I end up with all zeros, which seems like it ought to represent zero to me. Yeah? Okay. So what we've done here is by adapting the magic trick, we've actually found out how to represent the negatives. If you want to represent a particular negative number, first write down its positive version, flip the bits in the add one, and that gets you the representation of the negative version. Okay? And this works with one or two exceptions. Okay? It works with two exceptions, one of which is obvious, and the other of which is very much not obvious. Okay. How many numbers do you think? Well, what would happen if I did this to the zero? If I flip its bits and add one, what do I get? Well, try it. So I take the number zero, flip the bits and add one. Write it down. Let's write it down. Oops. What do I get? It's zero. Okay, so when I flip the bits and I add one to zero, I just get zero. Now, does that make sense? Yeah, because this procedure, it should, and here's why. The procedure of flipping bits and adding one is how we negate a number. Well, what's negative zero? So shouldn't we get the same thing? Yeah, does it make sense that we ought to get the same thing back? Because there's no such difference between zero and negative zero. They literally are the same number. Okay? All right. The other number that's weird is one followed by all zeros. If I flip all of its bits and I add one, what do I get? I get that. Okay. So now this one's interesting. First off, are you guys clear that if I take that number, I flip the bits and I add one, I get the same thing back? Yeah? What does that mean is the deep question. So what do you think this means? If flipping the bits and adding one is tantamount to negating a number, then I have a number that's equal to its own negative. Does zero satisfy that property? Sure. But I have another number that seems to satisfy this property. Right? Because would you guys agree that whatever this is, it's definitely not zero? Yeah? Okay, so the question is, what the hell is it? So this illustrates, well, okay, let me actually write it this way. What would it mean for a number to be its own negative? If I wrote this out in math, I would say something like this, right? Can I add x to both sides? Right? Or I could say this is 2x equals 0, for example. And if you guys were to look at that in a math class, how many answers would you find to this equation? Huh? Precisely one answer, namely 0. Well, I got bad news for you, gentlemen. We're no longer in math class, or rather, we're no longer in regular math class. Computer arithmetic works in a different universe than math, well, the math that you guys have all seen. And the arithmetic system is more like that of the clock than it is just regular numbers. Okay, now, if you guys will humor me for a moment, let's look at the clock up there. All right, now, I'm mildly bothered that it only has 12 positions on it because a true clock would have 24, right, because 24-hour time is the only way to keep time. And you AM, PM nonsense people. How do you feel about that, Ben? You completely agree. Okay. Yeah. So let's, for the sake of demonstration here, let's pretend that instead of 12, it's labeled 0. Okay? What time or what number on that clock, if you add it to itself, do you get back to where you started? Well, certainly if you have zero and you add it to itself, you don't go anywhere, right? But there's another answer on the clock. Huh? Well, 24, okay, but let's, yeah, 12. Well, but 12 is really zero, right? So what happens if you add 6 to itself? You get 12, but what is 12? It's 0. Oh, so there's a second answer in clock arithmetic. Well, that's weird. How many guys think I'm just like that I smoked a line or smoked a joint on the way into class this morning right now? If I smoked a line, then that would be really messed up, right? Okay, so let me kind of take a pause and let's talk about your math education and why this feels weird but also shouldn't. So when you guys learned how to do division in elementary school, do y'all remember that? How old were you? What grade were you in when you started to learn how to do division? In particular, long division. Second, third, fourth grade, somewhere in there? Yeah? You guys remember doing it? No? You don't remember second or fourth grade? Really? None of you guys? Vaguely? Vaguely? All right. So you learned how to do division. And so what would happen if the teacher gave you a question and it was, all right, I want you to divide 7 by 4. What would you say that the answer was? Back in like third grade, what would you say the answer was? 1 remainder 3. Okay? And then you got into middle school and the teachers said, oh, no, you're not in elementary school anymore. We're none of this remainder nonsense anymore. And what would you say then was 7 divided by 4? 1 3/4 or 1.75, depending on how you want to write it, okay? And they basically tried to tell you that the remainder thing was for kids, yeah? It turns out the remainder part is actually what's interesting, okay, in number theory. And in a sense, that's what's happening on the clock, right? We're working in remainder land where instead of the number line being a giant line, it's wrapped up into a circle and there's only finitely many positions on that circle. Okay, so 8-bit arithmetic would be like working on a clock that has 256 different positions. Why 256? What's 2 to the 8th? 256. Okay, so that's what we're seeing here is that in regular ordinary algebra, there's only one answer to this question. But in this sort of circular arithmetic structure, there's actually two. Okay. Now, we still haven't answered the question as to what this number represents. And it turns out it represents minus 128. Now, let's think about that. What is minus 128 plus itself? Okay, well, minus 128 plus 128 would be 256, right? Or, sorry, 0. What's minus 128 plus minus 128? Negative 256, okay? But I can't represent negative 256 with only 8 bits. I would need a ninth one. Do I have a ninth one? No, and so negative 256 is really the same as 0. Okay, in the same way that what is 12 on the clock? It's 0, right? So if I asked you, for example, to add 9 and 4, what would you get? You'd get 13, but what's the remainder 1, right? And it makes sense, like on the actual clock, right? And that's essentially what we're getting here, okay? So The two bizarro numbers, one of them is 0, and that's maybe not all that bizarro. Negative 128 is the other one. Okay, so moral of the story, this represents negative 128. And it is the smallest negative number that I'm capable of expressing with 8 bits. You give me more bits, I can do more numbers. But if we only use 8, that's it. Okay, so I need to move to a new sheet. So am I good to move to a new sheet? Hand on top of your head if you're good for me to move to a new sheet. Yeah? Okay, that's everybody's hand. I need to start passing out the cups. So that you guys see the cups on underneath the cart, there's red, green, and yellow cups, and the color of the cup indicates your status. And no, I will not fill up your red solo cups. Sorry. Huh? Hey, it works. right? I mean, there's a book or something I saw, and it was like everything I needed to learn about being a computer scientist I learned in kindergarten. It's not entirely false, right? And in fact, one of the things that as academics, and maybe, you know, I'm just as guilty of this as the next person, but what was kindergarten fundamentally about? What was the, if you had to have one word that described kindergarten, what would that word be? I would say play, right? You fundamentally were playing. Now, did you learn your alphabet and how to tie your shoes and how to make interesting little arts and crafts and things like that? And how to not use the scissors in other people's hair? And how to use the glue only to glue the macaroni to the paper and not to put in other people's hair? And how to not touch other people when they didn't want to be touched or touch them in inappropriate ways, right? All of those things you learned in kindergarten, but fundamentally you were learning to play and you were learning things while you were playing, right? We've beat the play part out of you. So why is this not play? I think it's play. I think it's fun. Okay, now is it as exciting as playing Cyberpunk? Or playing with blocks? Or going out to recess? I don't know. Okay, so as an unsigned integer, which I'm going to call a uint8, we can represent 0, 1, up through 255. As an int8, which is the signed version, I can represent -128, dot, 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 -1, 0, 1, dot, 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 up through 127, not 128. Okay, now let's think about it. How many numbers have I represented in either system? Total. 256. That makes sense. I've got 8 bits. 2 to the 8th is 256. And so what I'm choosing to do if I work in the signed or the unsigned system is just say, okay, with the unsigned system, yeah, 0 to 255, no big deal. With the signed system, I want to have some negatives. And so I'll sort of give myself half of the numbers as being negative and the other half not. So why does it only go up to 127 and not to 128? Yes, Jacob? Because zero's in the middle, right? So think of 0 through 127 as being the 128 things I get that are not negative. Yeah? So that's why it's 127 and not 128. Okay, so in 8 bits, those are the only numbers that are expressible. Negative 128 up through 127. Okay? All right, so we'll continue with this on Friday and also look at one of the interesting consequences of what happens if you don't have as many bits as you need. Bad things can happen. Okay? All right. See you guys on Friday.